Texas. My name is Brian Lane. I'm the director of debate here at Texas's highest internationally ranked debate team. Excellent program planned for you this afternoon. Before I begin, let me ask you please to take a moment and silence your cell phones. If you're here for a class, you need to sign up for extra credit. Mr. Alonzo at the front desk has a form for you for all those things. Now let me tell you something. Students from UNT, from all areas across the campus, are interested and involved in debate on campus. And it's my pleasure to begin this debate by inviting comments from our president of the student body, himself no stranger to debate. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Troy Elliott. Woo!
Thank you, Dr. Lane. So I just wanted to say on behalf of the University of North Texas Student Government Association and the students at UNT, I wanted to first welcome our international guests. Thank you for being here. As I said, I'm no stranger to debate. I did it in high school. It was really fun. This is a little bit different than the debates that go on with the preacher on Wednesdays that always comes to campus. So it's a little different. A little more organized, I'd say. So I think we're definitely in for a treat. I'm very excited to stay and watch. It's always a good crowd at the UNT debate. So it's always a very good look. So anyway, thank you again to our guests. Welcome to our campus, and hopefully you enjoy your stay. I'm very interested to see how this goes. So thank you all.
Can you hear me back there?
Yes.
Is this thing on? Beginning my stand-up back. We're also pleased to have greetings from our president of UNT Debate, which is one of UNT's oldest student organizations. Please welcome our president, Ms. Hope Sauceda.
We came to Texas hoping for some heat, but what a pleasant surprise. But so just a few comments. How many of you have heard about Rwanda? Quite a lot. So the first thing I'd like to give you a little bit of context to why we are here. As everyone, when they hear about Rwanda, the first thing that comes to their mind is the 1994 genocide, where in the space of 100 days, 1 million people were massacred, which is 10,000 people for 100 days. 3/9/11 every day for 100 days. And while all of that was happening, the world turned its back on Rwanda, because for the world, Rwanda was a place of no strategic interest. And those were the words of President Clinton. And but a lot of people, one of the things that they never hear is that unlike the Holocaust, see, when the Holocaust ended, a lot of the Jews went all over the world. So that some came to America, some went to Israel, and some went all over Europe. But in Rwanda, people were forced to live next to one another. So you can imagine the victims of genocide were living next to the perpetrators. and they had to interact with one another. But the main, this year we're celebrating 20 years after the genocide. And a lot of people don't know, but think about it. What about the young people that were born 10 years after the genocide, or those who were either too young to know, to participate in the genocide, but are still living in the consequences of genocide? And part of it is also looking at it from a perspective of the kids of the perpetrators and the kids of the victims. And part of what happens after a conflict like genocide is that a lot of people become silent, and because there's so much hurt, there's so much anger, there's so much bitterness. But from us, what we are working and trying to do is to encourage people to speak up. We're encouraging people to argument and people to voice their opinions, because we believe that debate can be a tool to build peace, and debate can be a tool to get people engaged with one another. So we are here on a tour that we call Voices from a Post-Genocide Generation, where for 2.5 months we've been going around the US and talking to different people about Rwanda and getting them to see a little bit the struggle of the post-genocide generation, but also the hopes of those who are refusing to bear the luggages from their parents, and those who are engaging one another and learning how to dispute and argue passionately, and also learning that difference is a good thing. So I would like to introduce the team. I'd like to ask them to come in front or stand up or something. So we're a team of 6 people. You're going to hear from the 3 of them. This is Brian, this is Casey, this is Ivan, and this is Teta, and this is Daji. So we are all part of a program called iDebate Rwanda, which is a debate program for high school students in Rwanda. We currently work with 22 schools, approximately 660 students, and teaching them the art of debate. And for all of us, we love debating because we think that it's not only a good thing, I mean, for competition. If you're competitive, definitely debate is for you. And but also we love debate because we're seeing that debate can be a tool for peace building. And we're seeing that in a post-conflict generation, we can use that as a way to get the youth to engage with one another. Without much ado, I'd like to thank everyone, Brian and also Hope, and everyone from the UNT debate team for inviting us today, and everyone for coming out. This is really amazing. I hope that you will enjoy the debates, and the topic is really relevant to Rwanda, and I'd love to see how it goes. But thank you all very much, and I hope you have fun. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Jean-Michel. Very eloquent. Thank you very much. As we've already heard from our Rwandan delegation introduced them, let me briefly introduce our UNT debaters, our 3 debaters that we represent in UNT debate. We're going to start off with Abram Hester. Abram, stand up. Yay. Studies in history. He won the Lawrence Williams Memorial Moot Court competition, and just this fall, he took 3rd place for UNT at the Tarrant County College Debate Tournament. It's our first trophy of the year for UNT Debate. He's joined on his side by Darian Carroll, who is a senior political science with a minor in psychology major. Darian's participated in debate at UNT for quite a while. He's participated in elimination rounds at Wake Forest University, the University of Kansas City, Missouri, and the Cross-Examination Debate Association. He's currently on the Dean's List, and he's on track to graduate cum laude. He's joined by our 3rd member of UNT Debate, Rhett Cranbeer. Rhett, can you join us? Rhett is a freshman who's majoring in political science. You might know he has the best minor in the entire world. He's minoring in awesomeness. Awesomeness. He's qualified 3 times for the National Forensics League. Aside from debate, he also volunteers at the Denton County Animal Shelter and with a local hospital. Now, let me tell you a little bit about the format for our debate. We will have 4 7-minute speeches in which the speakers will start off on one side and then the other, raising questions, comments, and issues back and forth. We'll then take a short break while out. We'll come back and moderate questions from the audience for no more than 10 minutes. Please raise your hand. We'll try and do the best job we can to recognize a variety of people's questions as we do everything. Then we'll have an opportunity for each side to have a closing statement of no more than 7 minutes. And let me say one thing. This is a very, very serious topic that we're discussing, but we do hope that you'll participate with us today. If you hear a point that you particularly like, we'd enjoy it if you joined with us, letting us know, hey, that was a good point, we like that one. Of course, if you hear something that's really bad, and I don't think anybody's going to hear a point that's bad, but you might want to tell them, poor Shane, poor Shane. We hope we don't hear that. You might notice, as the debate proceeds, that various speakers from the other side may stand up. That's called raising a point of information. You may hear that from time to time, in which the speaker is trying to interact with one another to clarify a point made in the speech. The debaters all know that this is going to happen. They're not interrupting one another, although they do have the option to accept a question or to pass on that. That's their option. Please join us in our debate by communicating on Twitter. We've set up the hashtag #RwandaUNTDebate. You might know that we're also live streaming this debate. Now, please keep in mind that the arguments presented today may or may not be the views of the speaker. In order to have a civil discussion, you may hear persons defending arguments that they do not believe in from time to time. In the name of argument, that is to say that all debaters play the part of a devil's advocate from time to time. In today's debate, the UNT debaters will be affirming the topic. We'll be debating the topic in the aftermath of genocide. Forgiveness is more important than justice. With all that being said, it's my pleasure to introduce Mr. Abraham Hester, the Prime Minister, for this afternoon's debate.
Hello everyone, I'm Abraham Hester, the Prime Minister of today's debate. I would like to thank the Rwanda team, everybody for coming here. Sorry you didn't get to see any cowboys or any heat in Texas, but our weather is just awful. But thank you so much for coming out. Thank you everybody for coming out and seeing this today. It's an especially important topic. So with no further ado, I would like to begin. Ray Serevov once stated, looking backwards should never divert our path to one of hatred and bitterness, for those steps lead nowhere but to destruction. To live in hatred is to miss the point of living. It is the belief of the government today that forgiveness is a prerequisite to justice, and that justice without forgiveness is vengeance. Therefore, in the aftermath of genocide, forgiveness is of more value than justice. Since the end of the 19th century, the world has experienced 26 official acts of genocide as according to the United Nations Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide, which defines genocide as acts committed with intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnic, racial, or religious group. Genocide is an act that showcases the most deplorable reaches of human savagery, the most peculiar act, and that it tends to stem from one or a group of calculated individuals who carefully orchestrate the massacre of whomever they particularly despise, based normally on some notion of superiority. The issue that faces us, however, is not the cause of genocide, but rather the reaction that victims should take following the end of the aforementioned atrocity. The question is, what is of more value? Forgiveness or justice? The President's affirmation, once again, is that the path of forgiveness is preferable to justice, and that it ought to be valued for the following reasons. First, that forgiveness is the highest extent of human strength. It cannot be polluted, and it can only lead to progress. Secondly, that justice is a subjective concept. It often leads to further atrocities when influenced by the fresh memory of violence. And then finally, that without forgiveness, we cannot have progress. And to frame today's debate, we have some definitions. First, forgiveness should be defined as of the general population, to cease to feel resentment against a group of offenders, to forgive the Hutu in general, for example, but not to forget the acts that were committed or the orchestrators. Same for the Germans in general after World War II or the communists in general. More should be greater in amount, specifically sentiment, value of relative worth, utility, or importance. And finally, justice, the maintenance of what is seemingly just, since true justice is impossible to define. So, on our first point, that forgiveness is the highest extent of human strength, we have to understand that there is not a greater act that one can take than to forgive another person, based on the emotional sacrifice and the practical application of some forgiveness. Jose Zalaquette, the Chilean human rights activist, once said that underneath truth, justice, and forgiveness lie the twin goals of prevention and reparation in the process of moral reconstruction. This formulation acknowledges that vengeance can be excessive or unquenchable, and that preoccupation with harms in the past can be debilitating for victims and bystanders. Instead, through forgiveness, victims can reassert their own power and reestablish their own dignity while also teaching wrongdoers the effects of their harmful actions. Go ahead.
Does forgiveness being the highest form of human strength necessarily mean it's more important value than justice?
It's more important to value because, and I was going to get into that just in a moment, is that if you don't have forgiveness when you seek justice, all you get is reciprocal violence. Because what happens is you have an infinite level of justice. Justice requires two parties. It requires one individual to say, you have wronged, and it requires the other individual to say, I have wronged. However, forgiveness only requires one party. And because of that, justice tends to become infinite. The victim takes justice against the perpetrator, who then becomes the victim. And then the victim takes actions against the perpetrator. And because justice is subjective, genocides, reignites violence after the perpetrators of the original crime have already been captured. We look to the post-World War II German expulsion. We have to understand that at least 12 million Germans were directly involved. It was the largest movement of trans any single ethnic population in modern history and largest among the post-war expulsions in Central Eastern Europe. Mark Shaw and W.D. Rubenstein described the expulsions as genocide because it led to the deaths of about 10 million of these people. What we have to understand is that when you have the fresh memory of this violence in mind, when you attempt to take justice for yourself, all that happens is that you become another perpetrator of genocide. Because the only reciprocation for the act of genocide ends up becoming more genocide. You attempt to remove the population that harmed you rather than to forgive them and then to take proper justice through the laws within your land. Because we have to ask ourselves, what truly can make up for this large loss of human lives? Nothing. So we simply have to move forward, hold those responsible, and teach people so that way we can move beyond this. According to the Gerson report, during after the Rwandan Patriotic Front invasion between April and August 1994, tens of thousands of civilians were massacred by RPF forces in retaliation for the Rwandan genocide. Now, this is not to say that justice should not be wrought, but what we have to understand is that civilians en masse will die. We have the same level of atrocity occur when individuals take justice into their own hands while still having this memory of practice. The Second Congo War was directly caused by the Rwandan genocide, which led to the death of 5 million more people. This is another example of reciprocal violence. What happens is that individuals attempt to take justice into their own hands, which will lead to more and more and more violence. The same thing happened in Armenia after the Armenian genocide, when the Armenians attempted to build a buffer zone so as to preemptively stop another genocide. In becoming the victim, rather than taking back their own dignity and educating individuals so as to avoid another atrocity, they continued atrocities against more populations, against those that they saw as being the perpetrators of violence, evil, in a sense. What we can clearly see is that focusing on a concept such as justice and not valuing forgiveness first directly after something such as genocide clouds the minds of those who were once victims. It makes them perpetrators of crimes against humanity, increasing their willingness to commit similar actions as taken against them, which turns justice into vengeance. Justice is blind, but she can't be guided by wrathful men. What we require is that forgiveness preempts justice, so that way we can avoid this infinite justice, reciprocal violence, and that we can have true justice take place. And we have to understand that progress requires forgiveness. This is the final point of the government today. And we look at the United States as an example, that post-World War II Operation Paperclip and forgiveness of Nazi scientists who weren't directly involved in the genocidal action led to huge scientific progress and helped us get to the moon. Not only that, a quote from Rwanda Immaculée Lily Bigaza states that Rwanda can be a paradise, but it will take the love of the entire world to heal her homeland. What we see is that for us to be able to move forward, for us to be able to come together, we have to be ready to reintegrate individuals into society so that we have move towards reconciliation and reconstruction, so we can rebuild a fair and more humane world. For this to be possible, we have to look to these ethnic groups and say, we forgive you as a whole. We will not once again victimize individuals. We will come together to not only educate, but to move further, so that as a society, we can one day rid ourselves of genocide. And the only way that this is possible is if we value forgiveness over justice. We avoid reciprocal violence that happens when the institution of infinite justice takes place. So because of that, the point of the affirmation today is that without having a prerequisite of forgiveness to justice, justice becomes vengeance. Therefore, in the aftermath of genocide, forgiveness is of more value.
Who's going to be forgiven? In genocide, the person who government believes forgiveness leads to justice. I don't care what the government believes. They said that forgiveness is the highest form of human strength. And for some magical reason which I don't understand, this means necessarily that forgiveness is a much more important value than justice. It doesn't matter that it's a high form of human strength. That's nice. But is it more important than justice? What they said basically, which is actually a very good point I didn't expect them to bring up, was that justice is infinite because it leads to more vengeance and more vengeance and more vengeance. But see, the problem is there's a short-sighted approach to justice that people see. They see justice as when someone does something bad, we're going to shoot them and put them in jail. That's not how justice is everywhere. That may be how justice is in the U.S., but they're different from the justice in the whole world. Yeah.
Considering the fact that you just addressed the fact that short-sighted justice, isn't that why forgiveness is important, so that we can have a proper legal process and have justice not become this short-sighted approach to something that's more
accurate? Justice is only short-sighted, basically. What I'm saying is there's justice in other countries. Let me give you an example. In Rwanda, when the people who perpetrated genocide, what they had to do wasn't just go to jail and get shot in the head. Yes, that did happen, yes. But people had to build houses for people. They would have to understand that the person in my arm is a human being just like me. What I have to do is I have to show them that I respect them and that I follow them. And so what they did is they would tell the people, here's a bunch, go and build a house for the person who's standing. And that's not a compensation. No, for the life they lost, no, that's nowhere near. But the fact is, that person then understands that there is a bond between us. You built a house for me. You helped me. You, even though you hurt me, you did help me. So I understand that we're both missing human beings. And you understand that there's different facets of justice. There's not only punish people. You have to understand that there's also retributive justice. There's traditional justice in South Africa. There's gachacha courts in Rwanda. There's so many different forms of justice. Sure.
You're talking about how there is a different form of justice in Rwanda. However, the United Nations seems to report that it will take until 2077 to prosecute those that are perpetrators of genocide in Rwanda. I think this moves to a point to say that there's a large amount of people that were perpetrators of violence.
Okay, yes, that's adorable. But the thing is, they said, the UN, I know that report, they said it would take, it would take much more than just 2077. But what they did is they decided to make the gachacha courts. Gachacha courts, basically what the UN was saying, is that in order for them to be tried as of how the Americans would try them, or how the English would try them, that would take 77 years, hundreds of years. Even some people said 200 years, for them to try them as Americans. But what they did is they tried them as Rwandese. They would take them and they would sit down in grass, fields of grass. And people who were very respected, would decide, would listen, hear the courts. And now, actually a year later, I think it was 2007, the courts have closed, everyone has been tried, and the people, and justice has been given. In the UN might say that, but the government of Rwanda understood that there are different types of justice. Rwanda had its own justice before the genocide, and it used that justice to save, basically to reenact the people. I have a few questions for you. Who is being forgiven? Is it going to be the whole population of the people who are persecuting them? Is it going to be the perpetrators? Is it going to be the government? Who's going to be forgiven? How does that help people on the national level? Forgiveness is nice, but on the personal level, not on the national level. And how do you measure forgiveness? Another thing, ladies and gentlemen, the affirmative is going to try to frame this debate on forgiveness is good versus justice is good. But the debate today is going to be about which one has more points in this special context of genocide. Justice is a prerequisite to forgiveness. I don't agree with you saying forgiveness is a prerequisite to justice. Because you can never really forgive a person until you feel like they've paid their due to humanity. You talked about Immaculée Ibadiza. Immaculée Ibadiza was basically a survivor of genocide. The people who killed her family and who actually tried to harm her, she met them. And she forgave him. She did. But when did she forgive him? She forgave the man who had attacked the family in prison. She talked to him while he was behind the bars. And she said, I forgive you. Why? Because she saw justice has been given. That's an example of Rwanda. And really, you can't say much because, come on. Another thing, forgiveness is not justice leads to impunity. The number one thing that people need after the genocide is for people to return back to normal. A nation cannot return to running like normal until people understand that when they do something wrong, they have to abide by it. And first of all, one of the major causes of genocide is that people don't understand that there is law. And people start doing things and there's impunity. People do whatever they want and no one cares. The government just ignores them. But the fact is that, But the fact is what we have to understand is that we have to return to normal. So there has to be punitive measures taken against people who do wrong. Not only punitive in means of punish you in jail or whatever. I've talked about that. Sure.
I just guess people don't commit genocide when there's a rule of law. However, wasn't a major part of the genocide against the fact that there was a minority government imposing their rule of law in Rwanda?
Yes, people were killing each other, but I'm not saying law in the country, I'm saying international. Forgiveness is a very personal thing, and after genocide, the whole nation has to return to normalcy. The fact is, people might forget it. Yeah, that's nice. But we have to understand that it's in the national level. We have to think of it, it's the difference, the reason why we think justice is more important is one, because of scale. Scale. Forgiveness is very personal. It happens in houses. Happens in little communities. But on the national level, in order for there to be reintegration of the whole nation and forgiveness between Hutus and Tutsis, the entire, both clans, and not just families, it has to happen on the national level. And the only thing that can lead to that is justice. Another thing, impunity causes crime and genocide. I talked about this enough. Because when people aren't punished, when people don't, when other people don't feel like this person has done has paid their dues to humanity, then basically that person can just say, hey, you know what, I'm going to go and steal. And if you dare come and lock me up after stealing, how come you did lock him up after killing my family? Another thing, there are many types of justice, and we do not defend one particular type. We're defending all different types of justice. For example, I talked about retributive justice. I talked about transitional justice. In South Africa, the justice that they gave was amnesty. Transitional justice basically brought back people, even the perpetrators from the highest levels of government were brought back into society. Why? Because that was South African forms of justice. In Rwanda, it was gachacha. In South Africa, it was transitional justice and the TRC. There's so many different types. Another thing, minds of people have to change. You have to understand that after a genocide, it's not just, people aren't just crazy. You have to change the minds of people. You have to bring them back to society. And so the only way to do that is to show them that what they did is wrong. They have to pay back what they've done to society. And the only way to do that is for them to be punished, for them to understand that other people who they've harmed are human beings. So thank you for your time, and God bless.
Before I begin, I'd like to thank everyone from the iDebate Rwanda team for being here and joining us today for this important discussion. And I'd like to thank all of you for being here to listen as well. Without further ado, let's begin. I'd first like to start off with a crucial argument. The first argument that the affirmative team in this debate is going for is that forgiveness is the prerequisite for justice to occur. At some point in the process of justice, forgiveness is required to believe that justice has, in fact, been served. Justice without forgiveness is vengeance. That's the crucial argument that Abe made in the first speech, and can easily slip into violence. Lasting peace requires changes in the attitude of people in each group toward the other. This change in attitude is even more necessary after intense violence, and the only chance for that lasting peace to occur is with the existence of forgiveness. Valuing forgiveness over justice does not mean that justice can't happen. It just ensures that justice doesn't go too far. And if our opponents can't come to terms with this crucial argument, then it's impossible to value justice first. They make a couple of crucial arguments. Their first question is, who are we forgiving? The people who we are forgiving is the perpetrators, and the people who are forgiving are those who witnessed the atrocity of genocide. We have to make a crucial argument that they are also making for us in a way. They make the argument that there are a lot of types of justice. This proves the argument that justice is insanely subjective. So in order for everyone to feel that justice has actually been served, we need forgiveness to exist. Because of the subjective terms of justice, some people may take justice too far. For example, Adolf Hitler once posed the question, after all, who remembers the Armenian genocide? The Armenian genocide was the extermination of the Armenian people by the invading Ottoman Empire. Armenia remembers the Armenian genocide, and Armenians exterminated the people of Nagorno-Karabakh without a second thought in order to attempt to stop a potential second genocide at the hands of the Soviet Union. Now, this is an instance that forgiveness might have a chance to be able to solve, because it would allow for us to resolve the different feelings of resentment that exist. More importantly, we have to realize that some people may take justice too far in recreating endless cycles of violence. This is definitely proven in instances of Rwanda, where violence occurred after the Rwandan genocide, in which some people took the justice a little bit too far. However, if we were to have forgiveness in this area...
You said that violence occurred after the Rwandan genocide, but you have to understand that violence was war and not justice. The Second Congo War was a war, and it wasn't a form of justice.
I agree with you. However, some people may disagree. The fact of the matter is that because of the fact the justice is so subjective, as you would argue in your speech as well, is that some people may not actually feel that justice has been served if they do not go as far as to forgive the or to forgive the perpetrators of genocide, and then they take it too far. Go ahead.
And then my question is, how do you plan for people to forgive?
What do you mean?
You say, for example, in the aftermath of the genocide, how do you plan for people to forgive the perpetrators?
Well, it's as simple as reconciling with them. In fact, you actually make a pretty good argument as to how forgiveness can happen. You can build homes with, or you can build homes with your neighbors. You can forgive them, and that does not necessarily preclude the fact of justice existing. It just means that we solve any potential violence that could occur in the face of, or in the face of genocide. The crucial definition of justice that we're making in this debate is that our definition of justice is a maintenance of what is seemingly just, which very much goes along with their definition because of how subjective it is. It is only important for the victims and the witnesses to have forgiveness. The highest goal for victims of genocide is not necessarily to find justice, but rather to receive forgiveness. They make another argument of how exactly forgiveness helps. However, Abe makes a pretty good argument in his speech as to how forgiveness is a crucial necessity to allow for progress to occur. He gives the example of Operation Paperclip, which was when the United States government forgave German scientists who helped perpetuate the Holocaust, and that allowed to scientific breakthroughs that allowed for us to reach into outer space and land on the moon. That is an example of forgiveness being a requirement, which proves that forgiveness is of more value than justice necessarily. The crucial question that we have to ask of is, what exactly does justice get us? Without anything else occurring, what did we get from the Nuremberg war trials? The only way to resolve a potential infinite cycle of violence is to have forgiveness in the cycle. Thus, forgiveness is more important and a requirement. The next crucial argument that we have to remember is the framing that Abe brings out in his speech. That our argument is not necessarily that we should forget genocide, but rather that we should forgive the perpetuators, which allows for reconciliation and allows for further progress into social justice. So it doesn't necessarily mean that we preclude all justice from existing, which is their argument when they make the argument that forgiveness leads to impunity. However, that's not necessarily true, because justice can exist, but forgiveness is the first priority. Forgiveness is of the most importance, and it is crucial in the cycle of justice in order to stop justice from going too far.
But why is forgiveness the most important? Why is it important?
It's more important because it's crucial to resolve any potential feelings that violence could occur, because some people may feel that justice doesn't necessarily happen, but also forgiveness is of more importance because of the progress argument that Abe was making in his first speech when he makes the argument that forgiveness allows for progress to occur. It allows for social progress and allows for scientific progress, as proved by Operation Paperclip after World War II. So at the end of this debate, if we are able to win the crucial argument that forgiveness is a prerequisite to justice occurring, then we will be ahead in this debate. Because justice isn't necessarily required, but more importantly, it isn't precluded by our argument. We allow for progress to occur, and we allow for a stop to potential cycles of violence that occur because of the subjective nature of justice. Go ahead.
Explain to me why Machiavelli is able to forgive after justice, and why forgiveness didn't come before justice.
I would say that forgiveness did come before justice. There's not necessarily a reason why justice is required for forgiveness to happen, but more importantly, the argument we're making is that forgiveness is just a requirement in order for justice to truly be felt like it has existed because of how subjective justice is, as you have argued in your speech as well. Alright. So at the end of the day, forgiveness is a requirement. It allows for progress to occur, and it allows to stop any potential violence that can happen in the face of genocide, because some people may not feel that justice is necessarily served because of how subjective it is. Forgiveness is the only way to resolve any of those problems.
Things that we need to know as the affirmative debate. I feel like the affirmative emphasizing on the key factors in this debate. I think they're forgetting out the word in the aftermath of genocide, forgiveness versus justice. I think they're forgetting that word, rather than more debating forgiveness versus justice. I mean, to any lovely, adorable human being, forgiveness is really cute. Anyone would want to forgive. But we need to understand, even in the aftermath of genocide, they need to understand in the context, as he said, in the context of genocide, which has more value. And now, a few questions that we asked you as the negative team. First, in the aftermath of the genocide, who's the perpetrator, who's the victim? And the other question is, I asked you, how do you plan for people to forgive? Because forgiveness is an individual feeling that you have in yourself to say, well, I take this honor to forgive you of what you did and everything. I don't think a certain country or a certain society will just come up and say, we've forgiven you, blah, 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 and then that's that. But we need to come to a practical solution. And this is the practical solution, forgiveness. If it was, then this world would be a paradise, I think. But let's just stop being so sweet and so cute that forgiveness will come in the aftermath of genocide, just like that. Because at the end of the day, genocide is a system. It's a systematic way of killing people. Meaning before you even kill them, you first humanize them, you classify them, and then even after the even in the aftermath of genocide, there's a way you need to build up a society. And dealing with the aftermath of the genocide, you need to deal with the problem from the roots. The only way you can deal with the roots is first by understanding the problem. The problem is not by just going there to drop forgiveness, just to drop up people of justice. That's not how the things are done. We give you a clear example of Rwanda, ladies and gentlemen. For example, what happened in Rwanda was, after the genocide, after years of people being dehumanized and everything done, justice came as a solution. Now, when he gave you an example of Ibagiza, she was... Now this is what that's what we wanted to answer you. If there is violence after the genocide, obviously after the genocide, a lot of people have been hurt in a certain way, and a lot of people have different feelings on what they feel. Some people even want to go for revenge. And that's why having justice needs to teach the other a lesson that you're supposed to have consequences for whatever thing you do. So that's why we need to understand clearly that even during the genocide, even the system of how the genocide is done, impunity is part of it. So having an aftermath of just forgiveness without impunity is just a way of promoting injustice in the future. We need a sustainable answer to both. We need a sustainable answer to unity and reconciliation. And forgiveness can't be the solution at that point. Because for years, people have been dehumanized, people have been killed. So at the end of the day, bringing a cute, adorable forgiveness would really be good. But is it practical? Because this is something. I need something that is practical. And I feel the affirmative is not giving us that. I feel like the affirmative is just debating. Forgiveness is cute. And that's why we think it should be there in the aftermath of the genocide. Yes.
You seem to be calling for a question of practicality. My question is, how do we heal the heart with more
language? Let me give you how we heal the hearts then, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, for example, what happened in Rwanda, it was that even after the genocide, what we did was restoration justice versus punitive justice. Basically, first of all, you first need to admit what you did,
be punished because you did it,
you killed people, and you did a lot of atrocities, you did human rights abuse, you have to suffer the consequences for that. And after that, after realizing your mistakes, after being punished, then there is
also punity.
At the end of the day, this
shows you that
when justice is served, it actually heals the process
and heals
the hearts of the people. And the hearts can, and the people that have been affected by the genocide can easily forgive.
But letting people just live in a society
where they can't be forgiven and just go there and sit down after killing, after raping,
after doing anything
and just tell people
to forgive,
it's not that easy.
She's talking about
a paradise which does not exist. I think they just...
Oh, no. I,
understand that justice engages people. After the genocide, I'm very lucky because I've been part of that post-genocide generation. Seeing what people go through, after the genocide, people are silent. Which is, now, when you talk about the aftermath of the genocide, you need people to forgive, for example, if that solution was even practical. But people, after the genocide, you find that people fear themselves. The perpetrators fear the victims. But justice comes as a way for people to engage one another. For example, during the Gacaca courts, the perpetrator was able to engage with the victim, understand the victim, ask for forgiveness, and that would be the first step towards engagement within the people. And at the end of the day, when you bring in forgiveness, I don't know if it would be that easy for a perpetrator to walk to the doors of a victim that easily and say, forgive me, I killed your family and all that kind of stuff. Then I forgive you. Oh, Lord, Father. Now, that would be so easy in the world where we're just living with the angel. But we need the affirmative to understand that after genocide, they're different. The genocide is a system that is organized in every kind of structure. That means it comes in every kind of structure that a country, a certain society should have. Socially, politically, economically. So, the only thing that can heal all those kind of structures is justice, not forgiveness. But rather also, we need for them to understand that justice, if done and served well in the right way, could even lead more to forgiveness if people are willing to be able to, if people are engaging one another. Thank you very much, and I hope you truly understand what an aftermath of genocide is and why we believe that justice can work best. Thank you very much, may God bless.
That we want to have our debaters discuss. Good question? Sure. Okay. All right.
Question for the UNT debate team. You all say to forgive, and it sounds like really easy, but when like millions of people die and they're your family, how could it be that easy to just say, like, I forgive you? How could there not be some kind of justice? Like, what? How, other than just saying I forgive you, how else would you go about it?
So the other team actually presented an example of this, which is the like amnesty form of justice presented in South Africa. We have to understand that forgiveness doesn't like exempt wrongdoers from justice. What we're saying is that in the aftermath of genocide, what you have to do is forgive the entire it's a general ethnic group. So rather than forgiving the actual orchestrators of this systematic like injustice, what you do is say, okay, Hutu, we can forgive you as a whole because of the fact that we understand that isn't like everybody's fault. So that neighbors can come together, that reconstruction can happen. What you have to do is understand that forgiveness needs to preclude justice so you can have true justice, so you can have a system of law rather than retributive justice, which is what we see happen in the aftermath of genocide empirically. And this is why we are forwarding forgiveness as value so we can have true justice.
I think justice is definitively an ideal, and that is why we believe that forgiveness is something that we can actually embrace.
When you talk about the aftermath that happened after the war, I believe the point that they're making is that's not justice, that's just a bunch of envy. Since you've admitted that justice is an ideal, isn't justice holistically has to be correct on both sides?
Well, the problem is that, like, once again, justice is a subjective thing. Like, there's nobody on this planet who can tell you definitively what is justice. So some individuals are going to say that what we need is retributive justice, which would be that what you do is you commit a genocide after a genocide, right? So it's like equal on both sides. And this is an issue when it comes to justice. We have to have forgiveness so we can have the forms of justice that are less violent, that would end violence and educate and bring a country of people together rather than continuing the cycle of violence that we see happen after genocide because individuals are thinking that the proper course of action is violence. And they argued that the war after the Rwandan genocide was not a form of justice. It was war. However, it was justified that the reason that the RPF went into the Congo was because of justice, to
take actions against the perpetrators of the genocide, which led to the death of 5 million people. So we see the cycle of violence continue.
That's the point from the other team.
Yes. Really, the reason that the IDF, the reason that the IDF went into the Congo was basically that the FDLR, the people who were orchestrating the genocide, were still in Congo. And there were people who were regrouping and trying to, and wanted to force their way back into the country. So what the IDF did is they said, hey, we're not going to let these people come into the country. We're going to arm up, we're going to go to Congo. We're going to fight them, and then we're going to reduce their power, and then we're going to come back to them. It wasn't revenge. It wasn't justice. It was war.
The problem is that the deaths of the innocent people that occurred during the Congo War were in a sense being attacked, and the deaths of these innocent people were justified by just war, right? This is a theory that justifies why you go to war and why you can have people die. And because of that, this war was a form of justice.
You have to understand that justice and war are completely different. We're not saying that the Congo War was a form of justice. Never. We're not saying that. We're not saying that the World War was a form of justice. No, never. We're not saying war is any form of justice. What we're saying is justice. It's retributive justice, transitional justice, punitive justice, never war against innocent people. Justice can never be against someone who didn't do anything wrong.
I see we have another question, y'all. Genocide is genocide. However, However, if we were to forgive, like, the German population, for example, after World War II, we don't necessarily massacre them to feel that we have, or to feel that we have justice. We allow for justice after that forgiveness happens, which allows for, like, progress to occur. That's why forgiveness is the first priority.
Well, join me in thanking our debaters. One more speaking opportunity from both sides. We'll start it off with a summary speech not to exceed 7 minutes from the government.
What's happening, party people? I am Gary Carroll. I'll be batting cleanup for the government today, and I don't think this mic game is going to work for me, so. Oh, real quick. Thanks to our Rwandan debaters and the Rwandan iRwanda debate for coming out. We really appreciate it. We think this is a great discussion to have. We definitely want to have more discussions about the things that are going on internationally. We would like to thank the SGA. Definitely dollar bills, y'all. Thanks, Troy, for coming by. And thank Brian Lane for being the best MC since Nas.
Heart-pounding thing that we have to go through. You ask us whether or not it is easy to forgive in the aftermath of genocide. Our answer to this question is sincerely no. But there are two points of stasis that we will have to combat and we have debated within this conversation. The first is that forgiveness is a prerequisite to any question of justice that we can ever have. And secondly, that justice is an unrealistic idealism that holds nothing for the future of a nation or for a people. But to begin, let us speak of forgiveness and the prerequisite that it has become. They speak of retributive justice. They speak of the future of Rwanda. They speak of how do we forgive the perpetrators of these great, most heinous actions. We say that it is a question of your individual act. It is a question of you looking your neighbor in the eye and recognizing that they have wronged you. Recognizing that there is never a thing that they can do that will be just. They can never give you your family back. They can never give you your mother back. But what we can do is we can forgive them. We can move on. We can have a better nation tomorrow. These are the questions of the government today. They say that forgetting in the aftermath of genocide is what the affirmative would do. We will never forget the abuses of Nazi Germany. We will never forget the cries of the Armenians. We will never forget the lives that have been lost in the struggle for black people in the United States, and most definitely we will not forget the deaths in the Rwanda genocide. But what we will understand is that justice will never be served. The question in cross-sex was how do we do this thing called justice? They seem to want to dodge our questions by saying that there is some Rwandan form of justice. There is this question of retribution. There is this question of how they will do things differently than the international community. And that is all fine and well. But at the end of the day, we must realize that that is only a form of forgiveness. Because to be just is to be equal. To be just is to be what you think is fair. They have no response to the question of what is fair for those that are dead. His question and his point was that we can never forgive for those that are no longer living. He's right. I cannot forgive for the ones that have fallen within the Rwandan genocide. And I have not come here as the government's final whip to say that we should. But what I have said is that as those people moving forward, as those tasked with building a better Rwanda, as those tasked with building a better world, our only choice is to forgive those perpetuators, to forgive the individuals that perpetuated this terrible crime, because we can no longer sit and wallow in the past. We have to plan for the future. And justice, they have not articulated to you how you plan for the future and a question of justice from the Rwandan side. So I think at that point in the debate, you probably think forgiveness is the better way to go. Now, they say that genocide is a system that dehumanizes and classifies, and that the only way to fix this wound is to bring justice. This is wholly untrue. My point in cross-sex was that you can never heal the heart. You can never heal a wound with more abuse. Violence only begets more violence. Anger only begets more anger. This is how things work. If they cannot respond to you and say that the anger, the violence that they wish to perpetuate in this justice will somehow make the world better or somehow be stopped, I think it even amplifies our argument that says that forgiveness is necessary even if you want to have justice, because at some point, enough has to be enough. At some point, we have to look in the eyes of those that have wronged us and say, my man, I understand that you had a moment where you made a poor decision. And I understand you've taken from me something I will never get back. But I can't say I will take that from you. Because for me to take it from you was no better than when you took it from me. So I feel like at this moment in time, we have to look to one of the best individuals in American history. Our man, Martin Luther King Jr., when he said we cannot be violent, when he said that we had to understand, sometimes you gotta be the bigger, better man, and you have to do what is necessary for your people to survive. And we can't just wallow in the questions of how we will abuse, and the questions of how we will become just. We must understand, we have to forgive them, and we gotta move on, y'all. We gotta know that things were done. We have to keep remembering these things, because the day we forget the abuse in Rwanda is the day it happens again. But we have to forgive them. We have to move on. You have to invite them into your home. And I know this sounds easy, and I'm telling you it's not. It hurts the soul. It hurts anyone's soul to forgive someone that will never be able to retribute to you the things that they have taken. But that's something we have come here and said you have to do. It sucks, right, to be the bigger, better person, to say we're going to move on now, to say that the world tomorrow needs to be better than the world was in 1994 and better than the world is in 2014. But that's our argument, that it's the only choice we have. Now, they say that we have a belief in a paradise. You know, as a black man in the United States of America, I don't really think paradise exists. But outside of that, I definitely think forgiveness is nothing like a paradise. Forgiveness is understanding that it hurts, man. That you gotta be the bigger person. That you have to make moves so that the genocide that happened in 1994 does not reappropriate itself into a genocide that happens in 2050 to your children. It's not just to be worried about yourself anymore, but to worry about the future. And I think this is a point that the negative never really comes to terms with. How do we come to terms with our future? We say that forgiveness is a necessary prerequisite to describing how the future will work. Because it is necessary for our children to grow up in an atmosphere where they do not hate other people for the wrongdoings of their fathers, but instead embrace them as their brothers and sisters to move on and make a better world. The bottom of Abe's speech is very good on this question of how to heal the future of Rwanda, the people have to come together. It will take the love of the world. I ain't never heard of love built on justice, but I've heard of love built on forgiveness. And I think that's the point, right? So I know I'm supposed to do this tagline stuff at the top, but our argument today is that in the aftermath of genocide, forgiveness should be valued above justice. Because forgiveness is a prerequisite to justice. And justice without forgiveness is vengeance. So today, ask yourself this question. Maybe not here, but once you go home. How do you rectify a genocide? What is reciprocal? The answer is a genocide. How do you forgive a genocide? It's hard, but it's possible. And you can move on, and the world can be a better place. So I think if that is the end of this debate and how we should frame it, then there's no other position, man, to forget. So forgive me.
Forgiveness without justice leads to impunity, and impunity causes crime. Throughout the concluding remarks that the speaker here has given, very sorry, I forgot your name, he comes here and he says that looking in the eyes of perpetrators and giving them forgiveness means that you come to them and you say, and I quote, my man, I understand that you made a poor decision. What he is saying here sounds so easy, but when a man kills my mother, rapes my sisters, and ends my life in the matter of 15 minutes, looking at him in the eye and saying, my man, you have made a poor decision. Nazis. Because you need to listen. Because what it's not just a board decision. What he has done is that he has dehumanized my family. He sees them as cockroaches. All right? Which is what they called them at the time. It is not as easy to go to a person and say, I understand what you have done. But the question here is, has he understood what he has done? Because at the time, what he sees himself is as a person who is told to kill because he has been trained to see a person as nothing but a cockroach. What we have here is we're saying that forgiveness is not bad. The debate is not about whether forgiveness is good or bad. We're just saying forgiveness and justice, which one comes before in the concept of an aftermath of a genocide. What happens in the aftermath of a genocide? As a 14-year-old standing before you today, as a person from the post-genocide generation, I carry the burden that my parents had to carry. This burden is not mine. But when you said you were going to forgive the Hutu people as a whole, I actually feel like a criminal. All right? When I have done nothing but lift what my parents have lifted for 20 years. What you need to understand is that justice is not for everybody. It's for those who have done wrong. Those who have done wrong need to suffer to the consequences simply because they need to understand the nature of the atrocity that they have caused. They say that we give them an example of forgiveness by giving amnesty and building a house. But I'm going to build myself a house and build you a house. And how is that supposed to be forgiveness? It's called, I'm really a constructor. I'm not a person who is actually understanding the atrocity of my acts. Because in order to be able to live with your neighbor, you need to reconstruct the environment that you destructed. What you have here is a person sit in front of another and say, ooh, I forgive you. If I'm the perpetrator, what's going through my mind is, why are you forgiving me? All I did is kill your mother. It sounds very normal to me. Because it needs to come from the mind concept. Because we planned this since 1959, ladies and gentlemen. 1959, we were writing down lists of people to be killed. We exiled people. We killed them as years progressed on. And what we have at the end is something that dropped. Forgiveness is not planned in what they're saying. What they say is that I'm going to sit with you on a random day and say that I forgive you. What is necessary here is to have justice. Because justice not only lets you see that what you have done is bad, but you actually understand that you at least deserve the smallest amount of forgiveness if it is going to be given to you. Because they gave an example of Imakine. She only gave forgiveness because she understood that the perpetrator saw the bad that he had caused to her. Because you need to understand that she lost everything, all right? She lost everything. He's not able to give her back everything. So is forgiveness not able to do this? Forgiveness is not going to give you back your mother. Justice is not either. But what you need to understand is that the little that I am able to give you back is my responsibility. I accept that I've done what I have done. What they say is that I'm going to give you forgiveness, and no matter what, I believe that, that you actually understand what I actually don't know. It needs to come from the grassroots. Because we state here that impunity causes crime. When you do not punish someone, I'm not even saying punish it, and if you do not understand the responsibility of your acts, I will do what I did again. Because I will not understand that what I've done is bad. If I sit in front of you, ladies and gentlemen, and I rob something from this lady right here, and she says that she forgives me, but I feel that what I have done is right, I will steal her back because it looks really pretty. You hear? Because you need to understand that what you have done is bad and that you accept responsibility and you are able to move on. Here is what's wrong with forgiveness. Because once I forgive you, it is only a one-way kind of love, and that love is not guaranteed. Because if you take away the biggest thing that I have, that I call family, that I call love, I will not be able to sit next to you and say that I forgive you. What we say only is that minds of people have to change. Forgiveness cannot come with justice after. Here is why. Because once I have forgiven you, I do not feel like I need to make you understand that you're responsible for your acts. But once you understand first that you have done wrong to me, Brian, I will only be able to forgive you when you understand it. But what you have is that I forgive him, but he does not understand what I have done. Therefore, I do not need to make him understand that what he has done was wrong because I've already forgiven him. Because you need to understand that forgiveness is not a prerequisite to justice. Because once you have justice put in place, such as the Chacha points, we emphasize on those, we were able to sit down and listen to what the other person has to say. As long as the perpetrator can listen to me as a victim, I tell you, you killed my mother. She was the only family I had. Do you understand the burden that I have to carry every single day of my life? Only when he is able to say, yes, I understand, and yes, I apologize, only we'll be able to be reintegrated into society that actually understands each other. Because you want communication, all right? Because people do not understand each other because they did not know each other, and they do not know each other because they do not communicate, all right? Why don't they communicate? Because it's only a one-way kind of thinking, where people don't even think the same. the same page, which is why we understand what we are doing is correct. When you have justice in the first place, I understand the burden of what I've done to you. You forgive me if it is what you believe you can do with your heart, and therefore we could move on. What they have is that I forgive you. We somehow live together. Somehow. And, therefore, peace is installed onto Earth. If I wanted to, I'd say we are the world, but we are not. We are two different people, right? I am a perpetrator, you are a victim, you're a victim, I'm a perpetrator. We do not understand each other. How are we going to understand each other if we do not understand what both of us have done to each other? I feel hurt, you caused the hurt. I'm sorry, I understand what you did was not caused by a poor decision, my man. I'm sorry. It is not a poor decision. It is dehumanization, classification, and planning in the first place. All these three things need to be changed. If they are not changed, you cannot be able to live together. Because in 1994, what they saw as my mother's family was cockroaches. And what I see now are humans living together. My uncle was dead. I do not want him to die. But the perpetrator actually does not understand to this day that what he has done to my family is wrong. Simply because he thinks that forgiveness should come. Here is why. If I forgive the perpetrator who killed my uncle, what he's going to think is that I am all stable in my heart. Because I will only play an act. I will show you a face of forgiveness while inside I am hurt because you do not understand how you have caused that hurt. You will only be able to understand why and how you caused that hurt if I am able to give you what you deserve. I'm not saying that you deserve punishment. I'm just saying that you deserve a wake-up call. You deserve to understand that you have done something bad. That retributive justice, punitive justice is not the only way of justice. Because talking to each other can be a way of justice. Ladies and gentlemen, if I built you a house, it's not because I'm a very good constructor. It's because I want to rebuild the environment that I destroyed 20 years ago. At the end of the day, what we have is that forgiveness cannot be a prerequisite to justice. It needs to come after. Forgiveness is a very beautiful thing. Yes, I will forgive you only if you understand me. Therefore, I end the debate by saying, ask yourself a question. Do you want a person to be forgiven without understanding what they have done? Or do you want to forgive a person only when they understand what they have done and they have paid for their consequences?
We are 83. assault and sexual violence, which is taboo and a problem in every society, not just in post-genocidal countries, is receiving some of the most aggressive forms and approaches of dealing with sexual violence, which is, by the way, a combination of both forgiveness and justice. And I would encourage all of you, if you have never thought about traveling outside of your world, if you want to know a country that is beautiful, where you can go trekking with the silverbacks, right, the gorillas, mountain gorillas, the animal kind, not the human kind, if you want to see and eat some of the most amazing food you ever will have anywhere in the world, I encourage you to consider Rwanda as you make adventures out there. To both of the teams, you are both to be congratulated on what a wonderful job you did. And we're so very glad to have you here today.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. King. We'll have one last opportunity for a response from Jean-Michel Havanese. He's going to join us for all of the Rwanda debates. Please, come up and everybody join us.
Thank you. We just wanted to make a few remarks before we end this afternoon. Part of what we were talking with Dedi and Teta as the debate was going on is, again, this might seem like a debate for many people, but for us, it's an everyday issue. Because for us, we are wondering, I mean, it's not some people somewhere, it's your father, it's your cousin, it's this neighbor who committed this, and you're wondering if they deserve justice or forgiveness. And just like they just said, I mean, in real life, it's both. It's both in a sense that I think they made a lot of arguments about how you cannot restore a life, but then also on the other side, I think even with the greatest form of justice, I think forgiveness is still important. And for us, as a post-genocide generation, it's also a way for us to rebuild a new generation, because in a sense, we have to forgive not only those who committed crimes against our parents or our siblings, but it's also, we have to allow for people to live once more again. Because I think one of the things that Casey said is a 14-year-old Hutu is not responsible for the genocide. But again, we have to create this space, and we have to create this country where everyone understands that us as young people, we're not neither perpetrators nor victims. We're all victims. We're all victims of the past, because we're meant to share and to carry the burden of things that we did not create, because a 14-year-old did not kill during the genocide or not even born. And part of what we have here, we have a few copies of what we call the Voices from a Post-Genocide Generation, A Wounded Generation Quest for Answers. This is a booklet where we just got the 16 people that work in iDebate to share their story. And through this, I'd like to read just a few things. It says, this book is just a small contribution from iDebate Rwanda on the conversation of post-conflict reconstruction. Through these pages, you experience heartbreak, anger, confusion, frustration, and hatred of those who are too young to experience the genocide, but who are dealing with its consequences on a daily basis. You will also experience a sense of hope from young people who are working to create a better world for their future children and non-children. You will learn how all of these wonderful people are coming together in a team called iDebate Rwanda to help the youth to think and speak a better world. At iDebate, we're all about the voices of the youth and using our voices to shape the future. Someone once said that it is those who have been wounded that serve humanity best. We hope that through our wounds and our determination for never again, we can inspire young people around the world to be the change that they want to be, and to use their voices to shape the world in the way that it should be. Because I think that what is happening in Rwanda is a mixture of two things, of human cruelty, but then also of the best that a human being can do, and human resilience. Because at the end of it, nowhere in the world has such cruelty happened, but then nowhere in the world has such goodness happened. And we are hoping that if Rwandans are able to live together, then no one has an excuse, no one in the world, no one in the world has an excuse for conflict, no one in the world has an excuse for anything else. Because one person said, a professor we met in Ohio, she She said that whenever a student complains about, oh, this is too hard, she gives them a book about Rwanda. Read it and watch it down, you can tell, right? But most of all, I mean, we are not just about sadness. You can see we have very vivid debaters. We have, you know, we have life. We have people who are doing everything to change the world and to make it a little bit better. I didn't say to make it completely better because we believe that our generation can just make it a little bit better and our children will do even more. So we just have a few copies. Honestly, I think that, of course, we give it to our very passionate debaters. And come on, let's thank them for a wonderful time. So we have the copies. I think I'll just leave it here. And but again, when someone invites you in our culture, when someone invites you to their home, you just don't leave anyhow. All right. So we would like to take this time to thank Brian and the whole UNT team. And we have a gift for them. And usually in our culture, when you have a gift, you have to perform, right? So if you think it's weird, it's not. So what we're going to do is. Ivan is usually our man. As you can see, he's very passionate, right? He does everything. He's a dancer, everything. So Ivan is going to perform it, and we'd like to pray. So, Ivan, the floor is yours.
Gushima, Mangangi, Hingwaza, Mujos, Mugabin Hor, and now Gushi, the Kanyawi, who was a very small Mugisha, who was a Yano, a hundred years ago, and I was looking. culture, when you appreciate what a person does, you bless their mother. So it's basically a blessing to your mothers and thanking them.